And it's great that we can come as a family to worship our wonderful Lord. So before we worship, I think everything you need for the for this week is on the weekly bulletin. But just to highlight a couple of things, the Ash Wednesday service on Wednesday this week. And if you still want to join a Lent house group just for the weeks of Lent, it's still possible to do that. But I think Corinne would love to know that today, if possible. And another exciting thing, this is half term coming up, and there's going to be a heart trail run by the family team, which would be a great thing for families who don't know what on earth to do with their kids over half term, which is probably all of them, I should think. So if you know any families who would love to take part in that one day, all the details about it are on the weekly bulletin. So let's come and worship. And I thought we would start by singing a great hymn together. So we're going to sing Crown Hymn with Many Crowns. So with those words of truth resounding in our ears, here are some opening words for us to say together. So let's say together. Great and wonderful are your deeds, O Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Lord, who shall not fear and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you. So with that wonderful prayer of praise, We're going to have Nathan joining us, and he's going to help us to worship a bit more. So Nathan, come in.
Thank you, Richard. Good morning, everybody. Let's continue worshiping. As Richard has said, I'm going to start with a song which is Forever and Give Thanks to the Lord. So do join in and sing with me as we worship God this morning. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise.
With a mighty hand.
With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. melody of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath that we could ever breathe. We live for you. Solid rock, and when things change around us and when It feels like there are storms around, Lord. You are faithful and you hold us secure. Back to Richard.
Nathan, thank you so much. So let's be just quiet for a moment as we think about those words and we recognize that God is our firm foundation and he is faithful to us. Let's just spend a moment just loving God together. Those songs talked about God's love, and they also talked about God's holiness. So that's a good time maybe to come to confession, to bring to God those things which we know haven't been right this week and that we want to ask for forgiveness. Let's just spend a moment bringing some of those things to God before we say this prayer together. In our sinfulness, we cry to you to take our guilt away and to cleanse our lips. Forgive us our sins. Open our eyes to God's truth. Strengthen us to do God's will and give us the joy of his kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And in our worship, we've recognized Jesus as our Lord and King over all things. And I thought we'd use these words as a creed because they express the kind of King Jesus came to be. They're words from Philippians, and they're a kind of model of Jesus's lordship. So again, let's say these words together. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Julie's going to come and preach, and she's going
The first Bible reading is from Jeremiah chapter 33, verses 1 to 18. promise of restoration. While Jeremiah was still confined in the courtyard of the guard, the word of the Lord came to him a second time. This is what the Lord says. He who made the earth, the Lord who formed it and established it, the Lord is his name. Call to me and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says about the houses in this city and the royal palaces of Judah that have been torn down to be used against the siege ramps and the sword in the fight with the Babylonians. They will be filled with the dead bodies of the people I will slay in my anger and wrath. I will hide my face from this city because of all its wickedness. Nevertheless, I will bring health and healing to it. I will heal my people and will let them enjoy abundant peace and security. I will bring Judah and Israel back from captivity, and we will rebuild them as they were before. I will cleanse them from all the sin they have committed against me, and will forgive all their sins of rebellion against me. Then this city will bring me renown, joy, and praise and honor before all the nations on earth that hear of all the good things I do for it. And they will be in awe and will tremble at the abundant prosperity and peace I will provide for it. This is what the Lord says. You say about this place, it is a desolate waste without people or animals. Yet in the towns of Judah and the streets of Jerusalem that are deserted, inhabited by neither people nor animals, there will be heard once more the sounds of joy and gladness, the voices of bride and bridegroom, and the voices of those who bring thank offerings to the house of the Lord, saying, give thanks to the Lord Almighty, for the Lord is good, his love endures forever. For I will restore the fortunes of the land as they were before, says the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In this place, desolate and without people or animals, in all its towns there will again be pastures for shepherds to rest their flocks. In the towns of the hill country, of the western foothills, and of the Negev, in the territory of Benjamin, in the villages around Jerusalem, and in the towns of Judah, flocks will again pass under the hand of the one who counts them, says the Lord. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the good promise I made to the people of Israel and Judah. In those days and at that time, I will make a righteous branch sprout from David's line. He will do what is just and right in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. This is the name by which it will be called, the Lord, our righteous Saviour. For this is what the Lord says. David will never fail to have a man sit on the throne of Israel, nor will the Levitical priests ever fail to have a man to stand before me continually, to offer burnt offerings, to burn grain offerings, and to present sacrifices. This is the word of the Lord.
Listen, let your heart keep singing. Listen to his constant speaking. Listen to the Spirit calling you. Listen to his inspiration. Listen
The second reading is taken from Mark 9, verses 2 to 9. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, they were so frightened. And a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you so much, Nigel and Anita, and thank you to the choir as well. So we're coming to time for the sermon, and I think Julie is going to pop up somewhere, hopefully.
I'm here.
Here she is. Great. Welcome, Julie. And I'm just going to pray for you before you speak to us. So thank you so much, Lord, for Julie. Thank you for all that she is and all that she does. And we pray that, and Lord, will you anoint our ears as well to hear what you want each of us to hear. Give us listening ears and help us to take from your spirit all that Julie has prepared. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Richard. Good morning, everybody. Has there ever been a time in your life when you have made a decision that others around you would consider to be unwise, given your current circumstances? Perhaps right now, any thought of foreign travel plans in 2021 would appear inconceivable or unwise, given the current circumstances, the possibility of disappointment, lengthy quarantines, and cancelled arrangements. And yet, of course, we hold on to the belief that one day that will be possible again. Sometimes, though, we make decisions despite our circumstances because we feel led by God to do so. I think of the young woman from Croydon who boarded a ship with no more than £10 in her pocket and a prayer that God would tell her when the time came to get off the boat. When the boat pulled into Hong Kong in 1966, God told her to disembark, and so she did. She made a lawless slum of opium dens, gangs, and prostitutes her life from then on, and has continued to live there ever since. Not something perhaps you and I would consider a wise and sensible choice for a young single woman. But she, Jackie Pullinger, obeyed and trusted and believed that God had plans for her life that she couldn't yet see, but she trusted in him. Well, I want to begin this morning actually with something that Jeremiah does just before chapter 33 that would seem to us a fairly unwise decision given his current circumstances. Because while he is confined in the courtyard of the palace guard, Jeremiah buys a field just outside Jerusalem. We need to bear in mind the point at this point that the city has been under siege for a year, and anything that's been growing in that field is likely to have been trampled down by the occupying soldiers. So it's pretty worthless. But nevertheless, Jeremiah buys that piece of land. Why? Well, because actually his cousin comes to him and asks him to buy it from him because he's in debt, in a sort of kinsman redeemer kind of way, so that it stays in their family. But fortunately for the cousin, God has already spoken to Jeremiah that this would occur and has told Jeremiah to go ahead and to buy the field. Jeremiah looks to God and trusts his word instead of looking at the current circumstances and thinking, well, actually, this would be a dreadful investment considering the field is in ruin and the land, of course, is about to be taken over by the Babylonians. Trust is not easy, yet we see throughout the Bible that God wants us to trust in him, even when our current situations seem far from perfect. Moses, David, they all had to trust God at times when their circumstances looked incredibly bleak. Noah trusted God to build an ark way before the rains ever came. Jeremiah is demonstrating his trust in God's promises that one day he will bring his people back and that Jerusalem will be restored. And he trusts God so much that he buys a worn-out patch of land as a down payment, if you like, because he truly believed that God would one day bring his people back to work the land and to live there. Jeremiah invests in a future he cannot yet see. And so as we move into chapter 33, we read that Jeremiah is still confined to the courtyard of the palace guards when God speaks to him again and reminds him that he only has to call to God and God will answer him. But not only will he answer him, but he will tell him of great and unsearchable things that Jeremiah does not yet know. God knows the answers to things we cannot yet see, because he sees the full picture. He sees things from a different perspective. He doesn't just see our current circumstances as we do. He sees beyond, to a time not yet in our view. One of my favourite programmes was Restoration Man where George Clark would meet people who had bought up dilapidated buildings that no one else would touch in order to do them up. They didn't just see the building as it currently was. They saw beyond that to a new horizon, to a time when, with some hard work and a lot of tender, loving care, that building would be restored to its former glory, and often with even more to offer those who lived there. God knows that Jerusalem will soon be in ruin, and he's going to allow that to happen because it's the consequence of their continual sinful lives. But he also knows that the days are coming when he will restore his people. He will bring health and healing. He will allow his people to have abundant peace and security. He knows that restoration can come after destruction, that mercy and grace flow after justice has been served. We see the pinnacle of that expression of justice and mercy coming together when we look at Jesus on the cross. God will cleanse his people and forgive them for all that they've done wrong, so that once more the city of Jerusalem will shout with joy and praise for their God, that will ring out over all the nations, heralding who the God of Israel really is. God says to Jeremiah, in effect, "You see a desolate city, yet I hear the sound of joy and gladness once more. You see a wasteland, but I see green pastures for shepherds to rest their flocks." These chapters, 30 through to 33, are often called the Book of Consolation because their primary purpose was to bring hope and comfort to those in exile. These chapters, as Roger said last week, they don't change the facts of what's going to happen, that Jerusalem is about to be taken over by the Babylonians, that the people will become captives and go into exile. But they do change the way people respond to their circumstances. They speak of trusting a God with a future that right now does not seem possible, but that he can work through all situations in his timings. Because the God of Israel is a God of restoration. In verse 14, God says, "The days are coming when I will fulfill the promise I made to Judah, to Israel. Not only will he bring them back from captivity, but he will love them, forgive them, restore them geographically, materially, and spiritually." Because this is a promise not just about restored land and restored people, but about restored relationships. It's about trusting the promises of God that they continue to stand despite our current circumstances. The promises of God go far beyond the immediate. They transcend time and place. They endure forever, as we sang about earlier on with Nathan. So not only will there be a short-term fulfillment of the promises of God when they will return from exile and rebuild the city of Jerusalem, but his promises go way beyond that. In verse 15, he says, "In those days and at that time, I will make a righteous branch sprout from David's line." These words speak to a time when Jesus will do what is just and right in the land. God promises that David will never fail to have a man to sit on the throne of the house of Israel, and that the tribe of Levi will always have priests to offer sacrifices before God, because of Jesus, who is the servant king and the great high priest forever. Christ fulfills the role of king and great high priest. He keeps constant fellowship with God, and he intercedes on our behalf so that we too can be forgiven and restored people, reconciled to God through Jesus. Jesus brought and continues to bring healing, security, peace, wholeness to all who trust in him. We read in the story of the Transfiguration how the disciples saw things from a different perspective up on that mountaintop. They see Jesus for who he really is, the Messiah, God's own son. The story reveals to us too that there is a whole other reality going on that we cannot yet see. The good news of God's promises are ultimately found in the gospel of Jesus, in his life, his death, and his resurrection. Because through Jesus's resurrection, God would bring about the restoration, not just of agriculture and of people, but the first fruits of a whole new creation. And this whole new creation helps us to move out our perspective further out to the end times, to an eschatological view of Christ, when he will return and there will be a new creation. This is when God's promise of restoration is completely finished, when finally God and his people are fully restored in a relationship of perfect love, obedience, and unity. The church plays an important part in God's restoration plans. We are called to tell others of God's love for them and his promises for a future beyond that which we can see. Just as he asked Jeremiah, God asks you and me, his disciples, to invest in a future we cannot yet see. We are called to love the lost, to feed the hungry, to house the homeless, to bring restoration to all sorts of people in all sorts of ways. Richard is going to speak to Andy and Martin shortly about the greenhouse, a project that we believe and trust that God has planned for Fetcham. We have some ideas of what we might be able to provide through that building, but only God knows the full impact the greenhouse will have on our community in years to come. Who knows what God will do in and through that place that may bring restoration to our young people, to families, to older folk who feel lost and isolated and lonely. Right now, we can only imagine what the plans are that God has. We see things on bits of paper, plans and ideas. But I believe that God has already knows the full picture of all that that place might be. If only we would trust in him. As we close our sermon series on Jeremiah, I want to quote from one of the commentators. He says, let us see with eyes of faith the vision of an ultimate future beyond even the final judgment, the vision of an everlasting covenant, of a people enjoying the undiluted goodness of God, a people pardoned, purified, and planted by God. That is the future promised by the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, accomplished by the cross and resurrection of his Son, guaranteed by the Holy Spirit. That is the future that is ours to contemplate now by the faith that is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That is the future, the real estate to which God holds the title deeds. That is the land purchased with a price, infinitely more than Jeremiah paid for his field. As we prepare to start our journey through Lent this week, may we trust in the promises of God, and may we look beyond our current circumstances to a time when we will hear again the sounds of joy and gladness, and a time beyond that when we will be fully restored in our relationship with God, forgiven and redeemed because of the one who is just and right, who reigns forever, our servant king, our great high priest, the Lord, our righteous saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Julie, thank you so much for lifting our eyes up to what God is going to do and what he can already start doing in our lives. So I think we're going to have a slide up, reflection slide. And let's just ask the Lord to speak to us. There's a nice big mountain there because I thought if we could reflect on the fact that God is so great and God's ability to keep his promises is absolutely sure. So Holy Spirit, will you come and speak to each of us? Will you help us to hear from you what you want to say to us personally today? Will you apply those wonderful truths that Julie has spoken about? So we may just want to open our hands in a receiving mode, in whatever way you want to receive from God. And there'll be a little bit of music now coming on to help us to reflect for a few minutes. So we're going to have a chat with Andy and with Martin now. I think they're going to somehow appear on a screen. And we're going to talk a little bit about the greenhouse that Julie's already mentioned. So welcome to Andy and Martin.
Morning.
Good morning. Thank you, Richard.
Hi, Andy. Okay, so will you remind us, why are we doing this greenhouse project?
Well, we saw an opportunity to help the Scouts with their project, which had been running for a number of years, to replace the Scout Hut on Cock Lane. And the Scout Hut has been well past its useful life for a long time now. It's very cold, it leaks, it's prone to flooding. And the area around the Scout Hut has rather gone downhill with quite a bit of antisocial behaviour and vandalism and so on. So it was really an opportunity for us to get involved in that and help.
So what are we hoping to achieve through this through the project when it gets up and running?
Well, we've made a lot of progress already on planning a really exciting community building to replace the Scout Hut. Working with the Scouts and the St. Mary's Loving Service team, we've drawn up some really exciting plans for a new building, which will be an environmentally friendly, warm, bright, light space for all sorts of community uses, but beyond that of the Scouts themselves. So the things that we're currently thinking about are a preschool, some youth groups, a range of activities for families, particularly parents of young children. Also for a cafe, which would be a great hub for all sorts of folk in the community, young people and also older people. So we really think this is going to be a great location. We'll have a fully accessible facilities, including toilets for disabled people as well. And we'd really love for this to be a place which the church can use to lovingly serve Fetcham and the community, and also to be church in the heart of the village. So we're really excited about all of that. We've got planning permission to do it, but we've still got some work to do.
Yeah, great. So how can the church be helping you at the moment? Are there particular things we can be doing?
Well, Richard, the organisations behind the greenhouse have already raised £900,000 towards the likely £1,400,000 costs. And we have a number of grant applications being processed at the moment. And we're grateful for the PCC's support. But the most immediate thing is Surrey County Council have recently launched a £100 million scheme over 5 years to support the development of community facilities like the greenhouse throughout Surrey. And a grant from them would enable us to let the contract this summer. So to support our application for a grant to the greenhouse project, we need to demonstrate that it has the support of the community. And that is where I think the church community can really come in. We are therefore asking everybody to please click on the link in this week's church bulletin and give the Greenhouse Fetcham scheme the thumbs up. Alternatively, you can go via our new website, greenhousefetcham.org, or via Surrey County Council's website, and look for the Your Fund Surrey. Surrey Council will be looking to see whether the scheme, as Andy has outlined, is supported by different age groups. So please ask any other generation, children, grandchildren, or grandparents who visit or live with you to do the same and to give the thumbs up to our application. The greenhouse aims to support, as Andy has said, the needs of all age groups. We really thank you if you could go online and give us a thumbs up.
So could I just thank Martin and everyone who's working on the project. It's a lot of work and a lot of people are putting a lot of time and effort in. And finally, I'd just like, before we move into our prayers this morning, to ask all of you to pray for the greenhouse and for the team. We've still got quite a few challenges that we need to get through. We need God's help to do that, to clear a path for us. And it's not just funding, but various other matters to do with the legal agreements and the uses of the building, working with Mole Valley, and really getting the community fully behind this project, as many people as possible. So please pray for us, for our energy to do this project and to see it to fruition, and also that the greenhouse will be as wonderful a benefit to the community as we think it will be. So thank you.
Andy Martin, thank you so much for bringing us up to date. It was a big part of what we've put in the profile, and I'm sure is interesting lots of potential rectors. So it's really important as a church we get behind this. And the second request about prayer, I'm going to move out of my chair and let Brigitte move into it, and she's going to come and lead us in our intercessions this morning, and I'm sure she'll be praying for the greenhouse.
So, Father in heaven, we come to you and we just thank you for this amazing opportunity to link a sermon with what we are going to do. Thank you so much, Lord, that at the moment we can see an old, dilapidated, leaking building, but you have given us the vision of a place which will sparkle with life, out of which life and love and generosity will flow by your Spirit. Lord, I just thank you for planting that vision. And I thank you that you will see it through if we stick with you. Lord, I want to thank you for all that Andy it will be right. But Lord, we also pray that you would break down the barriers of fear of some of the people who can't make that leap from the old building to something brand new and beautiful and serving everybody. I pray that by your Spirit of grace, you would come and work in the meetings, that you would bring understanding, and that you would reveal more of your vision so that more people can see it. And while we wait, Lord, would you prepare us? Would you equip us with your gifts, which we will need in a new way, in a bigger way, in a place like that, in a place that you are going to build? So, Lord, fill us as a congregation with hope, with trust in you, and with the willingness to change. Lord, we also want to pray for our new rector. As Richard said, we thank you that the parish profile has sparked off interest in some people. We thank you, Lord, that in that sense, our work is now done. Now it's really over to you moving among those who are looking for a new place of service, of leadership, and of help. Lord, I pray that you would guide the right people to apply. I thank you that you know, because you know the hearts of people. So, Lord, would you bring us the person, the incumbent of your choice to Fetcham, we pray. And again, Lord, we don't just want to wait until somebody comes. Help us to use this time to grow even closer together, to connect even more with each other despite of COVID restrictions. Lord, we have found some new ways in which we can relate to one another and can have fellowship in new ways. We pray that we would continue that, that we would be willing to move and learn more. Lord, I want to thank you for the families and the youth team. I thank you so much for all the inspiration you have put into Pam and Nathan. Thank you so much for the way they connect with the younger people, with great fun, and yet also with the word of your love and your truth. I especially want to thank you, Lord, for the inspiration of the Fetcham Heart Trail. Red hearts of love dotted all over Fetcham, and we can follow them, and we can see that those hearts are not just a decoration, but that they actually spell out a message. Lord, I pray that families would have fantastic fun to find that message, and that somehow your message would get through to their hearts. Lord, there is fun in Fetcham, and there is great sadness, there is pain, and there is darkness. Lord, I first want to pray for all those in Bethlehem. For Julie Kalman and Ben Kalman. We pray for Lynn Alsop and for Rosemary Ruth Smith's daughter. Lord, we pray that you would surround them, that each one of them would be aware of your presence in their pain, in their fear. But I also want to pray for their family. Yes, will actually touch their loved ones. I want to pray for those who are in residential or in care homes, Lord. Liz Crawford, June Williams, Mavis Lake and Tony Day. Lord, thank you that you love them. Thank you that you care for all their needs. And Lord, we thank you for the love we have seen displayed by so many carers. Again and again, would you strengthen those carers so that they don't just care for the physical needs of their residents, but that they would find creative ways in bringing life and joy into their homes. Lord, we remember Christine Kirby, who has died recently. And we remember those whose anniversary of death falls at this time. Nancy Hand, Joan Nash, Janet Sheldrick, Joyce Blake, and Derek Parmeter. And maybe we just take a moment, Lord. Each one of us knows somebody who is hurting, grieving, or struggling. Lord, let's bring those people to you now in our hearts. We lift them to you, knowing that we place them in strong but gentle hands. And that you want to be with them. So we turn together to say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
So we come to the end of our service. Thank you so much, Brigitte, for leading us in our prayers. And we're going to have our final hymn led by the choir. And it is Teach Me to Dance. So let's enjoy praising God together.
Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Teach me to move in the power of your spirit. Teach me to walk in the light of your presence. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Teach me to love with your heart of compassion. Teach me to trust in the word of your promise. Teach me to hope in the day of your coming. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. You wrote the rhythm of love, created heaven and earth, in you is joy without measure. So like a child in your sight, I just to see your delight, for I was made by your pleasure. Pleasure. Teach me to dance in the beat of your heart. Teach me to move in the power of your spirit. Teach me to walk in the light of your presence. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Teach me to love with the heart of compassion. Teach me to trust in the word of your promise. Teach me to hope in the day of your coming. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Let all my members express the heart that loves to say yes, a word that leads to obey you. Let all my energy blaze to see the joy in your face. Let my whole being praise you. Praise you. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Teach me to move in the power of spirit. Teach me to walk in the light of your presence. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Teach me to love with your heart of compassion. Teach me to trust in the word of your promise. Teach me to hope in the day of your coming. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart.
That's a great prayer to go out on, isn't it? Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. So let's say a closing prayer together. It will come up on the screen in a moment. Let's say together, in darkness and in light, in trouble and in joy, help us, Heavenly Father, to trust in your promises, to live in your love, to serve your purposes, and to praise your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us and all who we love and pray for, now and evermore. Amen. So thank you so much for joining us this morning. We have gone on a little bit, hope you don't mind that. So I imagine the coffee will take place in about 10 minutes if people want to join the coffee. And we wish you a wonderful week and look forward to seeing you again next week. Bye-bye.
Splendor of